Kwe. Good morning, everyone. I'm Mairi Brascoupé, and I work for Indigenous Theater at the National Arts Center. I'm Algonquin from Kitigansebe First Nation, and it's great to be here on my home territory with you today for both this live stream and in person for the folks that are here, along with these wonderful speakers. So Arctic Imagination is a speaker series hosted by the National Arts Center Orchestra and the Royal Danish Library. This is one of our sessions in the five-part conversation about the intersections of art and science as we consider the warming north and the implications of Transform Arctic because of climate change. So let me introduce our wonderful speakers here today. So first we have Kelsey Leonard. Dr. Kelsey Leonard is a water scientist, legal scholar, policy expert, writer, and enrolled citizen of the Shinnecock Nation. Thank you for being here today. And we also have Autumn Peltier. Autumn Peltier is the Chief Water Commissioner of the Anishinaabeg Nation and an Indigenous rights and water activist. So thank you for being here, and I'll give you an opportunity to give a little more introduction to yourself. So let's start with Kelsey here today.
Wonderful. Close enough. We are, we're good.
Not quite.
I'm just going to put that away. So Akwe Lanikasak, hello, good day everyone. I'm Dr. Kelsey Leonard. I am based at the University of Waterloo in Waterloo, Ontario, and I am the Canada Research Chair in Indigenous Waters, Climate, and Sustainability. And I'm originally from the Shinnecock Nation, but have been in Canada for about 7 years or so now, and really center my research program around how, as a global community, we can center Indigenous knowledge and Indigenous ways of knowing for our global conservation efforts, and particularly in addressing our current climate crisis. So I'm really happy to be here with you today and with Autumn and Mairi and having this conversation.
Hello, my name is Autumn Peltier. I'm 17 years old, but I turned 18, so that's what kind of stuttered a bit. But I'm 17 years old. I'm from Wacomicon on Manitoulin Island, which is a bit northern Ontario. And I'm the Chief Water Commissioner for Anishinaabeg Nation. I'm also an Indigenous rights activist, but I kind of focus on water rights within First Nations communities in Canada. And I've been doing this since I was 8 years old, and it's really just to carry on my Auntie Josephine's work, water advocacy, and uplifting Indigenous people and their voices. And I really highlight racism, discrimination, missing and murdered Indigenous women, like basically all Indigenous issues in Canada. So, yeah.
So I want to start off with, what gravitated you towards water, both personally and through the work that you're doing?
All right. Do we just keep just going in this little vibe order that we have? So in our language, Shinnecock means people of the stony shore. So being born as a Shinnecock individual automatically means you're a water person. And I think our ancestors probably had that in mind in calling themselves that, in calling us that, to note that for generations upon generations, one of our main responsibilities and purposes is to be shore protectors, is to ensure that that shore persists in continuity, and that we have a responsibility for that continuity, and to ensure it, and to care for it, and to know that where that land and water meets, that makes the shore, is such a beautiful and integral part of this planet. And so when people ask me, you know, how did you get into water? Why do you care about this? It's like, I think I was just born into it. And there's just this natal connection that we have as human beings to water. And that's something that was very much taught to me throughout my life, but then also reconstituted when I got to work with water walkers around the planet, including Autumn's late aunt, Miss Josephine Baugh. So it's just so important that we recognize that we all have a connection to water. It's just about how we steward it.
Yeah, I received the exact same teaching, but we say Anishinaabe people where I come from, And so the exact same thing, being born Anishinaabe people, we're automatically given like the right and responsibility to care and protect the land and the water. And so just kind of already having the Indigenous perspective and growing up learning about our culture, our teachings, our culture is very focused on water. And so I guess kind of having the connection, understanding of it, you have that automatic respect for it. And so you kind of feel what people are going through when it comes to not being able to drink your water for 30 years. And so you kind of understand. And even me, I feel like it was really when I was 8 years old, I attended a water ceremony. And at the time, I had no idea what drinking water issues were, because I grew up in a community where I was able to drink my water. And so where I was, there was signs on the walls that said, don't drink the water, not for consumption, and boil water advisory. At the time, of course, I have no idea what that means. And so I asked my mom, like, what does this mean? Like, why can't I drink the water? Why can't I wash my hands? And she told me, well, this community is on a boil water advisory. Again, I don't know what that means, but I go home that night and I kind of research what that was. And I'm watching videos of like the Assembly of First Nations and chiefs talking and all these different videos about how communities can't drink their water. So I had a slight understanding of what that meant, but I have no idea why at 8 years old, it kind of impacted me. And my thought process was, well, there's kids that are my age and younger that have no idea what it's like to drink clean water from their homes and their communities. And so that kind of sat with me, and that's kind of what made me feel very passionate about water and kind of already having my Auntie Josephine as my role model, who was doing the work that I'm doing now before me. And so, yeah, I feel like it's just kind of being born that way, being born understanding it and being born to like just being Anishinaabe people.
Well, you touched upon a lot of things that I was going to ask. So I guess we'll expand upon that. So like, where do you see the links between Indigenous knowledge, Indigenous rights, and climate activism?
Well, I think, you know, one of the things that's important to note, maybe that's why I sort of paused and listened to that question, is I don't think there's any separation of any of those pillars or components. They're integrally tied to one another. You can't have a healthy environment without Indigenous rights being respected and honored and implemented. You also can't have healthy humans without a healthy environment. And so when we think about what is the impetus for climate activism, it's basic human decency. It's about thinking about how do we create a world in which these universal rights are respected and implemented, and through that, not only we as humans thrive, but the planet thrives. And so, you know, one of the things when I heard that question initially that spoke out to me or sort of came to mind was that this was actually the first year that the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change acknowledged that colonialism has exacerbated climate change and has exacerbated the experiences of the climate crisis that we're facing right now. And that is so pivotal for us being able to empower change. Because if you recognize that colonialism has contributed and exacerbated colonialism, then we actually now have a diagnosis by which we can start to put forward a treatment plan. So, and we have to recognize that colonialism is not something solely in our past, but that it is ongoing. And so again, we are creating a lexicon, a language, a system by which we can diagnose the symptoms and ailments in our society and thereby put forward a treatment plan. And so we need to think about how do we dismantle the ways in which colonialism is still ongoing in our society, not just sort of the phrase of decolonizing, but the, you know, the actual dismantling of these colonialism impacts that shape the way in which different communities disproportionately experience the climate crisis. And so when I hear all of those things together, that's why it's so important, because colonialism names why those principles are interconnected, why we need Indigenous knowledge, because for so long it has been suppressed, prohibited, and often violently suppressed, so that we don't have the best treatments available to solve our current crises. And so now I think as we're getting more global recognition of the importance of Indigenous knowledge, Indigenous traditional ecological knowledge, we saw statements come out of the White House around that, mandating all federal agencies to create policies around how they will integrate that across their different programs and policies. We see the IPCC now more properly recognizing it. Climate assessments around the world by all nation states are starting to have chapters and dedicated glossaries and things around Indigenous knowledge, and not just sort of slapping it on there, but actually highlighting the ways in which our communities are resilient and are putting forward adaptation strategies that not only work for us, but probably could work for other places around the world as well. So I would just say, I think in response to your question, it's interconnected, and we have to realize the intersectionality of the varied experiences of communities around the world and how the solution is not a one-size-fits-all, but has to be really nuanced and context-specific.
You covered it all. Yeah. Well, how are you, as a professor, bringing traditional knowledge into spaces like universities that are, you know, traditionally colonial spaces, and bringing that into a university, bringing that knowledge to other students? And how is that sort of affecting the way that you do your work as a teacher?
It's an excellent question, because I don't necessarily, so academic institutions, for the most part, unless they're an Indigenous institution or a tribal college or university in sort of the U.S.-Canadian context, weren't made by Indigenous peoples for Indigenous peoples. So it's not necessarily that Indigenous knowledge should live in those institutions. That's not necessarily for me to say, and Indigenous is not a monolith, right? There's so many different types of communities and nations that make up that moniker. So when we say Indigenous knowledge, it's a multiplicity and plurality of knowledge systems. It's not just sort of one. And that's really important. So how it integrates into the university can be very, and should be very, diverse, and obviously come with consent and leadership from the communities who hold ownership of that knowledge. So for me, Indigenous knowledge comes in the classrooms just inherently because I am Indigenous. So the knowledge that I carry is Indigenous knowledge, and thereby that transference to students is a way in which we're starting to slowly embed knowledge within the institution, transform the way in which we think about pedagogy, the way in which we think about how students learn and how we teach. So that's a bit of baby steps. I think outside of that, it really is about universities and academic institutions providing resources in which Indigenous nations and communities can be the leaders and designers of research that implicate their communities and their people, rather than what we've seen in the past, which is sort of Western non-Indigenous scientists being like, oh, I have this great idea, let me come and study you. And so largely what a lot of my work is doing is trying to transform that relationship, end that extractive practice, and create more practices built on relationality, built on respect, built on partnership, built on authentic collaborations that are not led by the institutions themselves, but are led by Indigenous nations and communities saying, here's an issue or a problem or a research question of concern to us. How can you help us solve that? Now, I don't presume to be making sort of revolutionary changes across my own institution or across Canada, but I do think it has to start somewhere. And I think what I consistently do is just plant a seed and also tell people that you shouldn't do it that way. In my expert opinion, which I now have because I have many letters at the end of my name, don't do that. And so that's where you know, my life now centers. And I do think we make small incremental changes by each of us being active in our voices and sharing that. But yeah, I think that's what I'll share.
So Autumn, what does political activism mean to you in relationship to water, and how has it changed over your almost a decade of advocacy work?
Well, I've been doing this, again, since I was 8 years old, and I turned 18 in 3 days. I feel like the change that I've seen within that amount of time is really sad, because very little change has happened in that amount of time. And to think that my Auntie Josephine started doing this way before I was even born, and she continued to do it till the day she literally passed away. And so that makes me feel like, hey, I've been doing this for like 8 years. I don't want to be doing this till the day that I die. And it's the amount of change that I've seen, again, is just so sad. And to think that the government just ignores Indigenous people. I feel like it all ties into like racism, discrimination, environmental racism. There's so many things that it ties into. And because how can you let people go without clean drinking water for 30 years? But if this was to happen in Ottawa or Toronto or any major city, think about how fast that would be a state of emergency, how fast they would resolve that, and how fast they would have clean drinking water again. But like, I feel like that's where racism comes in to this issue a lot, because, you know, Indigenous people have been struggling with this for decades. So I feel like when... Can you ask the question again?
So where do you see, how do you see political activism having changed over the last decade? And like, what does it mean to you to be an activist?
Yeah, and I feel like kind of going off of that again, how much has changed is not really anything has changed. And, you know, Indigenous people and government have a long history and a dark history. And I feel like that history is still the exact same. It's just not talked about. It's more just kind of like swept under the carpet, like it's not happening. And that's why I do my advocacy, because Indigenous issues are ignored and swept under the carpet. 2 weeks ago, a young girl at my school, I go to Algonquin College, she was raped and murdered, and she was Indigenous, and the only media coverage that you've seen was Facebook and Instagram, and that wasn't even media, that's just people like using their voices and talking about it. And so I feel like Indigenous people in government, it's the exact same relationship we had 50 years ago. It's the exact same thing. And so yeah, I feel like, I honestly don't feel like the government's ever going to change, but that's why I do what I do, and that's why we all are advocates and we all use our voices, so yeah.
And how do you, with the work that you're doing, how are you encouraging other people to share this message, or what other ways can people bring their voices to this cause?
Well, besides my advocacy, one of the things that I talk about is like empowering and uplifting youth and young people, because my personal opinion from my experiences and people that I've encountered in all of these years was, I guess the best people that I've encountered was the young people. And I found that the young people had the best things to say and the most powerful and important things to say. And, you know, the older generations don't really look at that because we're kids, we're too young, like, why does what we say matter? But I found that the most important and most impactful things came from the young people, because you generally wouldn't think a young person's going to speak up and talk about world issues or political issues. So that's, I find it so much more powerful and important, because, you know, that's when you know something is wrong and that we need to do something, because, you know, we are young people. We shouldn't have to be worrying about world issues. You know, that's when you know something has to be done. So that, I guess, empowering and uplifting the youth and young people is so important.
Yeah, I think you see a lot of young people across the world are the main people doing a lot of the vocal work around climate change and advocating for policies. And I mean, you talk to a lot of different people in government and in positions of power. What is that like as a young person to do a lot of that work?
Well, I mean, it's starting to get easier now as I get older, but working with politicians as like a 13-year-old was not really like, I find it was almost not useful, because it's, again, like I said, it's like, what is she saying, why does it matter? And so that's kind of what I ran into for many years. But now that I'm like almost 18, I feel like it's a bit easier and people are a lot more understanding, which I think is kind of not right. But my experiences with politicians really is like, I find it's really just all for the pictures. And it's really all just for the being able to say, yeah, I did it. I'm the first one who spoke to her. I tried to do something, but really they didn't. It's just, you know, they do it for their image and their public image. And because I've been doing this again since I was 8 years old and nothing has really changed, there's still communities that haven't been able to drink their water for 30 years. And so it's literally come to the point where I teamed up with an organization and I'm the one. And me and this organization are the ones who, you know, the government's not going to do anything, so we are going to do something. And we're providing short-term solutions for communities that can't drink their water. So it's come to the point where the government's not doing anything, again, for Indigenous people, that, you know, this organization has helped me step in to help these communities. So
yeah, so what are some of the key messages that you are trying to communicate within the work that you do? And how are you communicating them?
Well, there's a lot of different ways in which I think we try to communicate. Maybe one of the bigger messages is just be better human beings, be decent human beings. It seems simple, but it's a real challenge for the global community. I think it also, this was Climate Week at the UN and in New York City, and there was a wonderful speech given by the president of Colombia, and I don't necessarily know, you know, if you would subscribe to their, you know, other political agendas within the nation state of Colombia, but the speech was really powerful because it talked about the power imbalances that exist around the world and the way in which the global north, nation states like Canada and the United States, they consume gluttonously to the point where other parts of the world are feeding our consumption. They are having to suffer, and not just humans, but the natural world too. When we want brand new floors in our house, when we want granite countertops, when we want these different aspects of consumerism across the global north, those resources have to come from somewhere. And usually it's nations in the global south that are feeding our gluttony. And so we have to rethink the ways in which we consume, the ways in which we practice NIMBYism throughout our lives, which is, oh, well, it's not in my backyard, I can't see it, so it doesn't matter. It does. There are communities that are suffering so that you can have a brand new floor when you just put one in 2 years ago, right? So we have to think about why we do the things we do. And COVID, in a lot of ways, helped us. It helped us to process what a supply shortage is. To process what it looks like when a shipping container can't get to you fast enough because it blocked a canal, right? It taught us to have a better understanding of the entirety of our global system and the supplies that we consume. Because for many people, through the click of a button, won't name the company that's also after a rainforest, but for most people, that click of the button is just so, it promotes the idea of NIMBYism. It promotes our ability to make other communities invisible. And we have to reckon with that. We have to reckon with how that is promoting the current crises that we exist within. And so I think, you know, that's a big message, is trying to communicate to individuals to be better humans and to practice that in a way that is sustainable for you, but then also for the planet, right? And when I say sustainable for you, I mean that's in the immediacy, that's in the short term. What can you do today that helps to create a more sustainable planet by a choice that you make? And then sustainable for the planet in the long term is how can you contribute to a larger change that will help shift planetary well-being and healing? Because those two are different, right? Having better consumption of water in your household is important. It's just important to be a better human, to know how you're consuming and to consume less. But you changing your household consumption at your individual scale is not going to solve our global water crises. You need to then do something additional to help to shift at a different scale. And so scale is also important. So it's being better humans, understanding the scale of shift and transformation that we need. And I'd say the last message that I often try to communicate now in the work that I do is transforming our legal systems, right? We can transform at the individual level. We can try and transform at a scale larger than the individual, community, regional, national. But then we also need to transform the law, because currently our existing laws legalize the destruction of nature. They legalize the destruction of nature up to a certain threshold. A certain threshold that allows us to, oh, well, we'll be able to pollute this water body just enough so that we can still find some human utility and benefit out of it. But that is still legalized destruction. We need to transform our law and legal systems around the world in such a manner that we don't legalize the destruction of nature, but we legalize the protection of nature. Right? That the exemption is not for pollution, but the exemption allows for you to create some new type of conservation area or effort, et cetera. And so how do you do that, right? It's okay, well, this sounds good. What is she talking about? How do we actually put this into practice? Well, it's a new body, an emerging area of law. For us as Indigenous peoples, it's actually really old law, natural law. But for other parts of the world, it's an emerging area of law called earth law, or rights of nature, you might have heard it. But rights of nature, we kind of see earth law as this big tree. And under earth law is rights of nature as a branch, is animal rights as a branch, is the crime of ecocide. There are all these different branches that we need to more fully implement and more adequately allow for there to be a spread of coverage and creation of these laws in different jurisdictions across the world. And so those are probably my three messages. Be a better human being, you know, think about how you can address these problems across scale, and really look at how we can transform our legal systems so that we no longer legalize the destruction of nature, but rather its protection and recognition of its inherent rights to thrive, right? In that way, law thereby becomes the mechanism for which we say, we are not going to view nature solely as a utility for human benefit and consumption, but rather that it has inalienable rights too, to exist and to thrive and to be healthy. So those are some of the messages.
Well, the key ideas of like what I talk about is really just like uplifting Indigenous people in general. I touch base on a lot of subjects that have to do with Indigenous people, and I guess it's really just kind of like changing the negative stereotypes, because Indigenous people in Canada are so looked down on, and I feel like that's kind of why we're at the bottom of the list when it comes to, you know, getting help with water. So, like, water is a basic human right, and we're still, you know, going 30 years asking for help, asking for clean drinking water. And so, yeah, that's, I guess what I really do is just kind of trying to change the negative narratives that Indigenous people have. And, you know, right now I'm extra passionate about missing a murdered Indigenous woman, because I've, for my first time, experienced it firsthand at my school. Well, not really firsthand, just kind of being such a close ally to it, I guess. And, you know, just like knowing that this young woman went to my school is really, it just really impacts me in a way. And, you know, it's just a prime example of how our people are treated in Canada, because, you know, this young woman was coming from Nunavut. She was Inuit. She was a young Inuit woman, and she was coming to study nursing. And you know, our people, we try to succeed in life, and these are the types of things that happen to us, and that's a prime example of it. And yeah, just really trying to change negative narratives for Indigenous people, and trying to get justice for people that don't have clean drinking water in Canada. So that's really what I talk about.
I think too, with what Autumn just shared for others, if you may not have made the connection before, you know, there's an area of this work called ecofeminism, right? And for those that may not be familiar with that term, I encourage you to look it up after today. But it really centers the relationship that we have as women with the natural world. And, you know, there are, you know, many Indigenous scholars, Sarah Deer, for one, is an Indigenous legal scholar, who have made the connection that the rape and violence that we see, the missing and murdered Indigenous women that we see around the world, is directly connected to how we treat the natural world as well. They are inextricably linked. And so it was similar to the conversation, the question that you started us out with, you know, around how does, you know, Indigenous knowledge and the climate crisis connect? You know, it is so connected, because we see it replicated in these instances. We see it replicated in these extreme moments of harm and violence, that if we can treat other human beings this way, and particularly not just any human being, but Indigenous human beings this way, why then do we have any ability not to then treat the natural world in a more extreme way or similarly violent way? And there's a lot of literature in this space. And I think, you know, to Autumn's point, her, you know, her work and her advocacy to want to, you know, now be also a voice for missing and murdered Indigenous women is inextricably linked to the water injustices that she also fights for, because you cannot separate them. If we are still allowing for there to be missing and murdered Indigenous women around this world, then of course then we're still allowing for there to be threatened waterways and polluted waterways, because they are linked. The damage that we do to women is the same damage that we inflict on the natural world. And there are studies and scientists that have been advocating and articulating that for many decades. And unfortunately, we as a global society have not awakened to that knowledge. And so, you know, hopefully if you do take something away from today, I know I will, from what Autumn was sharing, that's really, really important, that if we continue to see these young women and girls violated, you are going to continue to see us go down a path of climate catastrophe.
That brings me back to another thought, actually, is because another part of my work is uplifting and empowering young Indigenous people, because we're raised in a society, we grow up in a society where we're kind of ashamed to be who we are. And that brings me exactly back to that, because, you know, there was a point in time where I was ashamed to say that I was Indigenous, that I was First Nations. And so, you know, we're, you know, like, society kind of makes us, like, ashamed to kind of be of color. And, you know, just, I feel like any person of color can kind of relate to that. And especially being Indigenous in Canada, you know, I've come across a lot of people who are ashamed to say that they're Indigenous. And, you know, women, Indigenous women are kind of, like, put down because, you know, residential schools, it was the main goal was to take the Indian out of the child, to strip us of our language and our culture. And, you know, it kind of, you know, you see the impacts of that to this day. I felt the impacts of that exact thing. And so I feel like, you know, missing a murdered Indigenous woman and discrimination against Indigenous people and water advocacy, it all ties in together. It all has to do with it.
Yeah, that reminded me of Marie Clement's play, The Unnatural and Accidental Women, and the start of it is a logger cutting down trees. And then the whole story is about missing and murdered Indigenous women in Vancouver. And we see our artists using their art to communicate these things, to talk about the environment, to talk about the issues happening around Indigenous rights. How do you see art and climate activism aligning in the world?
Well, I can start. At a personal scale, my sister is an artist, so I think my brother's sort of maybe the proper natural scientist. He's a marine biologist, although I've sort of started to dabble in that space. And my sister is the artist. And then, I don't know, there's me somewhere in the mix of whatever I am an amalgamation of. And I am always so blown away by her work. And I guess this is my time to be able to, you know, brag a little bit, be a bit boisterous for her. So if you've been to the Met recently or are planning to go, you should. There is a Water Memories exhibit which features her work. And you can find her work in major museums around the world. One of the pieces, though, it centers the way in which, again, this question and context around consumption, I mentioned earlier for you, is it features a palette of whale's teeth made, she's a ceramicist, so made of ceramics, made of clay. And it shows the way in which during the late part of the 19th century and early part of the 20th century, when we had sort of the boom of the whaling industry, where we were using whale blubber and oil to facilitate our desire for lighting in our homes. And we gluttonously consumed whales along the Atlantic coast and throughout the world to the point where they were on, and still are in many instances, the brink of extinction. And so the palette speaks to this, the palette of teeth in that particular piece speaks to the way in which we have consumed gluttonously, oftentimes without consideration, right? There was a point in our history, our human history, where seeing a palette of teeth was just like, oh, okay. And it was because also it was one, we didn't maybe think about it. We're like, oh, it's just a whale. That's there for our human use. Or it was, oh, they're so plentiful that's just the byproduct of our consumption. But now there's so few whales, you couldn't even make that palette out of real whale teeth. And so when I get to your question of how is, you know, art and our condition of our current climate crisis experienced, it is pivotal. It is the mirror that we need to hold up to each other to better understand how we are making poor choices. And it's a way also in which I now start to integrate art throughout my courses. And that's, you know, for environmental science students, of which I teach, they're like, art in an environmental science class? Yes, poetry, song, meditation. Yeah. We have a whole generation of young people, thankfully, that have been given the lexicon and the language and the words, terminology, to voice concerns around their mental health, but not solutions. So yes, if you are, you know, if we have a generation of youth who in the classroom are expressing social anxiety, are expressing a variety of anxiety across a spectrum of different ailments and symptoms, why not start a class with meditation? Why not give them tools by which they can think about how to be better scientists in their everyday practice when they are going to continue to face issues around anxiety and feeling overwhelmed and feeling not fully themselves in a day? So art, I think, is a great way to facilitate that. Art helps us to imagine a better world for ourselves and for others, and it also helps to think about an emotional connection to what we're doing in our everyday lives. So ultimately, art is a part of the human condition, and if we're trying to create a planet that is livable for humans, you can't have a planet without art.
I guess we'll open up the floor for some questions, both in person and online. If anyone has a question, someone will come around with a mic and ask. We got a question over there.
Hi, first of all, I just wanted to say thank you so much for taking the time out of your busy days, I'm sure, to speak to us all. It was really informative. I was just curious, what do you think the most pressing issue facing Indigenous women in Canada is?
Well, I talk about it a lot, and I'm going to say I feel like missing and murdered Indigenous women is kind of the biggest issue for Indigenous women in Canada. I would say personally, because even me, you know, I'm 17 turning 18 years old. As a young Indigenous woman, I fear for my life every time I walk outside of my house. And I shouldn't. You know, that's when you know something is that's terribly wrong. Because, you know, I was reading a post the other day. It said Indigenous women have a 12 times more likely chance of getting missing and murdered than non-Indigenous people. And so that kind of sat with me. And again, it gave me a little bit more anxiety than I had. But yeah, I feel like right now, Indigenous women, missing and murdered Indigenous women is like kind of like the biggest issue that Indigenous women face in Canada right now. And yeah, I just kind of like, you know, even like me, when I travel a lot for like the work that I do, I travel internationally, and just being, again, I'm going to say it, be just being young Indigenous woman, I question everyone and everything. And I kind of feel like, you know, I feel like every Indigenous woman is kind of like that, and it shouldn't be that way, but it is, because that's just the society that we live in. Indigenous women are targeted, and, you know, I don't feel like I should feel unsafe, but I do feel unsafe everywhere I am and who I talk with everywhere I am and everyone that I talk to.
Yeah, I would agree. I don't know that there's, you know, a more pressing issue or concern right now. I think, though, but it's all interconnected.
Okay. Thank you for the question. No worries. Take care.
Yeah, so I think to what Autumn said, you know, we really do have to address missing and murdered Indigenous women and girls, and Indigenous persons more broadly. We see that too across, you know, for trans women and trans men. There's a larger movement around addressing the racism and discrimination that we see in the country. And like we said earlier, that connects to the broader symptom of environmental racism we see then across communities and particularly across First Nation territories around Canada.
Do we have another question? We've got a couple.
There you are. Hi, this has been wonderful. And I'm just wondering, because you're so clear-headed and articulate and strong and courageous, where did that come from in your upbringing?
You want to go first, Autumn? Well, maybe related to the first question, strong Indigenous women. I think if you have, you know, strong strong role models and mentors in your life. They really help to guide you and to position you in that way. And for me as well, I think probably maybe similar to Autumn, I often try to think back to what was that moment where I got the public speaking bug or wanted to have more of a voice than what I had before. And probably similar to Autumn, you may not recognize this, but was also a very shy person. So I, lots of stage fright, very shy, all the way through high school. I think it was probably around maybe 16 or 17. I was a part of, I had my first opportunity to go to a youth event, a Native youth event, Indigenous youth event, and it was put on by United National Indian Tribal Youth, UNITY, which is a national and somewhat international Native youth organization originating out of the United States. And I went there, and I just saw other Native youth like myself who were just fabulous and talking and up on microphones and leading sessions and workshops, and I was like, whoa, that's really cool. Like, I want to do that. I think I have something to say, and maybe people want to listen to what I have to say. And so through that, there were these opportunities where, as young people from different regions, you could get up and sort of give a sort of recitation of what you had heard throughout the conference. And I volunteered to be one of those people that would do it for my region. That was my first sort of experience talking in front of, you know, a really large public crowd, about 3,000 Native youth of my peers. And it was in that moment where people kind of applauded, or it wasn't as scary as I thought it was going to be, and I found my voice. And from there, and then I just love the organization as well. Like Autumn, it was like, why don't we have more instances of these opportunities for our Indigenous young people to speak? We have so much to say, but we often are silenced or not listened to. And so to be amongst each other and to hear and to listen to each other and to value what we have to say, the UNITY bug bit me at that point. And I was very much involved with the organization. I went on to be a co-president. And so now, you know, like Autumn said, I'm a really, really big advocate for Indigenous youth voices, because ultimately at the end of the day, they're our current leaders. They're not our future leaders. As Autumn, she's sitting here as the chief water commissioner for the Anishinaabe Nation at 17 years old. Like, you know, that is amazing. So that's a bit of where my power came from, other people.
Yeah, well, with me, I kind of believe everybody has that voice and courage within them. But I feel like, more specifically, Indigenous people are with being looked down on, kind of discriminated, we're kind of like shy or scared to show that. But, you know, I was fortunate enough to have people in my life who encouraged me to use my voice and be proud of who I am as an Indigenous person. Like my grandfather, my mother, and my Auntie Josephine were my biggest mentors, always teaching me about the culture and to be proud of who I am and learning about the water and the importance of it. So I kind of already had those mentors in my life to kind of push me towards that path. But for people that aren't fortunate enough to kind of have those mentors or have those role models, because not everybody has that, that's why I do what I do. I encourage youth and young people to be proud of who they are. And again, more specifically, Indigenous youth, because again, we're discriminated, we're looked down on. And so it's simple. I kind of use my voice to help other people, other young Indigenous people, be proud of who they are and use their voices and kind of remember to not be, you know, not feel down or feel embarrassed to be who you are.
Hi to you both. A theme this week that we've heard recurring in these talks has been the constant ignoring of Indigenous knowledge and stewardship of the land, particularly in regard to the climate crisis. An example was the wildfires in BC and ignoring, you know, Indigenous knowledge for keeping the land safe, controlled burns, etc. When you think about water and safeguarding and stewardship of the land from that perspective, what's your view on hydroelectricity and dams?
Well, that's a heavy question. Well, from an earth law perspective, rivers should be allowed to run free and wild. So, you know, we've had an overproliferation of dams and hydroelectricity across the complex of the Americas. And when we got to a point within the United States and Canada where we had run out of ways in which to manipulate a river system, we then exported that knowledge and that sort of hydrocolonialism to other parts of the world and have, you know, just begun to gluttonously manifest the economic benefits of that in other parts of the world. And yet we know that 100 years from now, you're going to go through a process of decommissioning because you know that the environmental impacts of that dam are going to make it so that a species will be on the brink of extinction, like salmon, or some other type of flow issues will arise that create even more problems than the benefit that you will get from hydroelectric power. So what I like to say to folks is that not all renewable energy is just. We do need a just transition. We need to transition away from fossil fuels, but we need to do so in a manner that doesn't replicate the bad practices and colonial behavior of the fossil fuel industry, but just doing it under a greenwashing of, oh, well, it's hydro. Oh, well, it's wind energy. No, if the burdens of that energy system are still disproportionately burdening some communities over others, while a small minority and largely the oil oligarchs getting to just transfer their wealth to renewables, that's not just. So unfortunately, to what Autumn said earlier, I'm not seeing a lot of movement in that space. I think we are replicating fossil fuel colonialism in renewable spaces, and I'm it's hard to see a way out of it. There's actually a really great podcast that just came out recently called In Trust. It documents the way in which indigenous people, particularly the Osage Nation in Oklahoma, were, you know, violently, their land, their wealth, their head rights to oil during the 20th century were violently stolen from them. And the way in which the lack of a fiduciary responsibility being upheld by the federal government in the United States, or a fiduciary responsibility here by the Canadian government, when that is not upheld, when indigenous sovereignty is not respected, the type of violence that occurs, economic violence, of the loss of intergenerational wealth it's almost unfathomable until you hear it in this podcast laid out for you episode by episode. And that's just in one small pocket of northern Oklahoma for one indigenous nation. There's thousands of indigenous nations around the world and other communities of color that happens to every single day, even in 2022. And it's happening now in the renewable space as well, my nation included. And unfortunately, it seems like I'm shouting into a black hole and no one hears me. So what do I think about hydroelectric? We need to think about the ways in which, you know, what are the economic costs and benefits of that that also present costs and benefits to the environment. There are ways in which to reimagine hydroelectric so that it does not have the level of burdens that it currently is presenting to communities. And, you know, if you want hydroelectric, you know, why don't you put it in Toronto? Why don't you, you know, put it in places in which you actually have to live and to deal with the consequences of that choice? That's where, when we think about renewables, that's what needs to happen more concretely, is everybody needs to have a share of the burden, and everybody needs to have a share of the profits.
She answers things very well.
Hi. Okay, so I'm going to make this about myself a little bit, but I work for the government, like many people here in Ottawa, and I know that you two have experience either speaking to politicians or perhaps you in your academic career, you've had the chance to work with governments. Right now, I feel like I'm in a position of power in terms of, even though I'm at the bottom of the pyramid, I do have, I could make a change. I'm just wondering, what kind of advice would you give those people in government that want to give people like you a voice, people like you opportunities, but perhaps don't even know where to start?
I think you can start by kind of advocating for like collaboration and working together with Indigenous people and non-Indigenous people, because I feel like that's very important, especially in Canada. And if it's like decision-making on terms of like Indigenous people, then I feel like it's definitely important to have, you know, those types of people in conversation, just kind of including in collaboration, I feel like is my advice.
Yeah, I mean, that's excellent advice. And thinking too as well around, you know, maybe having a briefing paper or something that you actually sort of invest that additional research into and bringing that to your larger team, or to, you know, your specific department. You know, what is sort of the current state of your collaborations with Indigenous peoples and governments? Where has it been? Where could it go? You know, putting forward a policy memo around that. I think if you have weekly or some sort of standing team or staff meeting within your agency or department, making sure that Indigenous peoples are, you know, a standing agenda item. Like, be checking in around these topics and issues that are pertinent to your role and the power and privilege that you hold. I think oftentimes, as I mentioned earlier, that sort of NIMBYism, out of sight, out of mind issue is what we face very, very consistently. So just keep it at the forefront of your mind and other people's minds, and that's a good step in the right direction.
We actually have an online question. The question is, after hearing scientists, businessmen, artists, policymakers this week with very concerning messages, you're giving the first message of hope. What would you tell to the youth who want to speak out on behalf of the environment? How to encourage youths and anyone to advocate?
Again, it's just using your voices, and I feel like that's the most important thing. I mean, not everybody is kind of built for using their voices, which is okay, and there's several other things that you could do on the side of that, like social media. We're living in a generation where social media is such a big part of our daily lives, and so using social media platforms is another way that you could kind of simply advocate and use your voice. But another thing that I did, which is a bit more complex, but I wrote letters to my local members of parliament in like high figures, and I did not expect to get responses, but I did. And I feel like that's like another way that you can kind of use your voice or kind of just advocate in general, because that's what I did. I wrote a letter to, again, my local members of parliament, the prime minister, and ironically, even the queen, and they all responded. So, yeah.
Good.
We had a question up
the
front here.
This is for Autumn. So how does it feel to show younger kids that they can like speak up and be powerful when at their age you might not have seen that representation?
Well, actually, I'm gonna start by saying that being a young advocate is not easy, and it never was. You would not think that there would be people against what you do or have bad things to say, but I find it's no matter what you do, there's always going to be negative people, and that's kind of what I ran into. But kind of just being, I guess, the odd one out and being that kind of role model for people to also be the odd one out is so important, because that's what I did. And I faced bullying because of that. And, you know, there's always going to be obstacles like that. But that was the biggest, like, lesson and the best lesson for me, I guess. Because, you know, now I know to, you know, be careful what I put my energy into and kind of, like, be careful who I surround myself with. And it's just being a young person, using your voice is not easy, but you can do it. You can do it. And I did it. I'm 18 years old now and I'm still doing it. And yeah, I strongly encourage young people to use their voices. It's so important. Like, no matter what people say, it's just, you got to keep going, because that's what I'm doing. You know, I'm trying to be like someone who is the opposite of the negative stereotypes of Indigenous people. And so I just, that's what keeps me going. I have a goal, and I'm very like, I guess I'm very passionate about my goals, and I feel like I encourage people to be very passionate about their goals as well, because I'm slowly achieving it, but I'm passionate that I'm going to do it, so I'm still going.
Do we have any other questions in the room? Well, I have a question. We were talking about how do you have you're looking forward in a positive way. and it can be a heavy weight to know what is happening in the world and happening in the environment. How do you keep your mental health when you're doing this kind of work and knowing what you know? How do you keep a good mental headspace and keep that positive outlook?
Well, I think one thing is when you are working to be an advocate for the planet is to also recognize that that energy that you put into the planet comes back to you tenfold. So when I am feeling overwhelmed, it's usually about then going back to nature, right? Go stand by the water and just listen. Go be in a forest and just, you know, watch the trees, you know, and the leaves just rustle over you. Like, there is something, you know, that we have to recognize as human beings, that we are here through a gift of this planet, right? This planet has allowed for us to breathe, to, you know, continue to exist, and is always there, no matter what we do to it. Well, at least for right now, it's always there. No matter what we do to it, to allow for us to have those calming experiences, those grounding experiences. So, you know, I think it's important to go back, to just be able to be in nature, to have your place in nature. And even when you're in urban environments, that is nature too. So just finding those moments to pause, to breathe, and to listen.
For me personally, I went through a point in my career where I didn't give myself a break, and I didn't realize that I needed a break, and that's what made me realize that I was facing burnout. And because at a point in my small career, there was a lot of negativity, and it kind of brought me to a point where I felt like giving up and stopped, like, I can't do this anymore type of thing. But that's kind of where it was a big realization point for me, where I realized, what kind of role model am I going to be if I give up and let people get to me? What kind of role model am I going to be for the young kids who are 4 or 5 years old that are looking up to me? You know, like, I realized that I had to find things that I enjoyed doing besides my advocacy, because yes, my advocacy is important, but there's also things that I need to do on the side that I enjoy as well, to give myself, you know, the calming, to calm down and rest, because it's very important aside from the important work that I do. You know, and, you know, the things that I do, I work out. That's something that I found that I liked within the last year and a half. I actually bodybuild, which is really random, but, you know, that's something that I found that I enjoyed doing besides, you know, my advocacy. And yeah, I feel like it's very important to have that balance between, you know, your mental health and, you know, the important work that everybody does. So.
Do we have any other questions in person or online? No, I've got a question here.
Thank you both so much for your extraordinary sharings today. And Mairi, thank you so much for your beautiful hosting. I have a question for Autumn, which maybe is a private question, I don't know, but I'm curious to know what you are studying. And then I have a question for both of you after.
Well, I'm currently in college and I'm studying, like, it's an Indigenous Studies course, and it's just, you know, deepening my knowledge that I already have, but, you know, just kind of getting that knowledge at, like, a post-secondary level, I found was kind of important to me. But it's only a one-year program because I didn't really feel like I was ready, like, for university yet. So I kind of, like, took that little break in between, but middle of this year, I am applying, of course, to university for next year, and I do plan on going into, like, politics. So my future career plan is politics.
Powerhouse. It's very exciting. And then this is for both of you. I was really glad that you brought up Earth Law, Kelsey, and I was super interested when Bolivia came forward with this Charter of Rights for Mother Earth, you know, 10 plus years ago, and then have been trying to track when this is happening, like personhood being given to, you know, an Aotearoa river. What's happening within what is currently referred to as Canada around rights of assigning personhood or this kind of thing?
Yeah, so it is, we had the sort of first river recognized in Canada in March of 2021. That was the Magpie River, which is was recognized through a co-governance agreement by a local Quebecois municipality and the Innu First Nation. So what was really interesting about the Magpie River, it was largely led by Innu youth for that movement and recognition and that the creation of that law. Particularly if you're bilingual, the law is in French, so you can go and read that. But one of the ways as well to track some of the other initiatives, there are other interested or sort of movement building initiatives around recognition of the St. Lawrence and the Ottawa River. The local Ottawa River Keeper has been working on advancing that. So if you're local to the region and you want to particularly learn more, I would reach out to the local Ottawa Riverkeeper. In terms of, there's some movement on the Pacific Coast in BC, again, led by First Nations for recognition of different waterways. One in particular, the Sturgeon River, but there are some other initiatives that are ongoing. There was at one point a initiative for the recognition of the Great Lakes. It was brought to the floor of Parliament, but it was not taken up further from there. So we might see more initiatives around that, particularly if you recognize the St. Lawrence, because they're connected. I think Canada is still emerging in this space, and hopefully we will see more initiatives in the next 5 to 10 years. That said, largely further behind than initiatives that we see in the U.S. and then elsewhere in other parts of the world, like Aotearoa New Zealand and across different countries in South America. But if you're looking to learn more about Earth Law, there is the UN Harmony with Nature Initiative. So you can go, I think it's unharmony.org, and that has a timeline with all of the different rights of nature initiatives that have passed in the recent sort of years or decade. And then a collaboration between myself and international law scholars around the world has put together what we call the Ecological Jurisprudence Monitor that will be launching in October. So you can look at ELGA.org as well as come October, you can search for Ecological Jurisprudence Monitor on Google, and it will be a global mapping interface where you can search by jurisdiction or by natural entity for an initiative.
I guess I'll have one final question, unless we have no other questions in the room. My dad always said that his goal in life is to get non-Indigenous people to love nature the way Indigenous people love nature. And what ways do you think people can love nature the way Indigenous people love nature? How can we connect people the way that we are connected to nature?
I think the first step to doing that would be like educating yourselves and others, because I feel like the proper education is the most important thing when it comes to understanding Indigenous people and our perspectives. Because I've come across a lot of people who have questions, and a lot of it is kind of like incorrect information or one-sided information, and I feel like having the proper knowledge before just having the proper knowledge is very important.
Yeah, I think the idea that I will share is actually something that Autumn's aunt Josephine would advocate for, and I would ask her similar to, it's interesting, you know, that Autumn is sharing this sort of the despondency or the sort of jadedness that we feel when we don't feel like politicians or the government is listening or doing anything. And so when I was working with Grandmother Josephine and with other water walkers, I would ask them, I'd say, so, you know, what do you think about, you know, politicians and government? Like, is there any hope for them? You know, can they change? And they were like, it was, you know, majority resounding, no, no. So I was like, well, then what motivates you to keep, you know, doing this work for the water and, you know, for walking for the water? And they said, young ones, young people, and even younger than Autumn. They said, you know, the hope is in those toddlers and JK and sort of kindergartners, preschoolers, that if we can instill the love for water and the love for nature there, then they will learn to continue to steward it throughout their life, because again, they're closer to that natal connection. They're just a few years removed from that birthing experience. And so I always carry that with me in terms of, yeah, politicians may be a lost cause, still try, but we do have to think about educational reform. You know, we have to think about how do we steward that love for nature, that connection to water in preschool, in JK, in those sort of formative years. And so, you know, for each of you in this room and those listening in on the live stream, it's also to think about, you know, for your children, for your grandchildren, for your, you know, nieces and nephews, how is that connection being stewarded for them in those formative years? You know, are they just stuck wholly in a classroom, or do they have, you know, environmental education? Do they get to learn outdoors? Do they get to even learn about Indigenous knowledge and Indigenous ways of knowing in those formative years? Because that's really, really important to how we develop human beings who are conscientious and caring and loving of Mother Earth. So,
actually, I feel like something I'll add on to that has to do with the education is I feel like it's important to have something that's mandatory, especially in Canada or North America, to like have an education system where you can learn about Indigenous like culture and people, because I feel like that's where a lot of lack of knowledge is in the education system, and that's where, you know, kind of really needs to happen. And because, you know, as someone who's in post-secondary, just came out of high school, what I noticed is like, again, the lack of knowledge of Indigenous people and their culture, and I kind of feel like that's where like discrimination and racism can come in, because you lack the understanding of Indigenous people and culture, where we come from, and, you know, why we go through certain things or why we do certain things. And I feel like kind of like having mandatory education systems about Indigenous people and culture is so important.
Yeah, and to what Autumn just said there, you know, the mandatory aspect is needed, because it sort of goes back to what she said earlier as well, where, okay, you feel like politicians and government aren't doing it, so then you have to go and do it yourself. And we sort of see the same thing happening in the early childhood education space. There's a program that her Aunt Josephine and the author of the Water Walker book about her, Joanne Robertson, have helped facilitate with an elementary school teacher named Peter Cameron out of Thunder Bay, called the Junior Water Walkers Program. And so now classrooms, about 60 around the world, have volunteered for that program. They get a water box, and they have sort of instructional materials and curriculum that allows for the students in those classrooms to facilitate and foster that connection to water. But why can't and why shouldn't that be mandatory, right? The fact that we have to have, you know, an elementary school teacher who, you know, has a day job, have to do all of this, you know, additional work, and thank God, you know, they did, because now we have this beautiful program that's emerging around the world and connecting young people in classrooms in this really unique way, and as a legacy and testament to her Aunt Josephine's work. But we need that to be more consistent and mandatory across the board, not just in Canada, but it's, these are global problems, so we need global solutions in that particular instance around education.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and is there anything you think, as we leave this room today, that people can do right away for the environment, for climate change, even something small?
I think I'm just going to highlight again that encouraging and empowering young people is very important, and that is one of the first steps that we should take to kind of changing the narrative.
There's so many different steps. So I feel like you have to, pulling off of what Autumn said earlier, pick something that you're passionate about, because passion really can drive, as you can see here as a testament, all the good work you can do in the world. So definitely picking something that you can be passionate about. Maybe not a self-promoting plug, but maybe a self-interested plug, do something related to earth law, because I'd really would love to see more initiatives like that emerge across Canada. So they can range from a local township ordinance or resolution to something as big as a recognition of the Great Lakes or a parliamentary bill. So there's a lot of different ways in which you can support earth law. And so what I will say too is there's an organization called Earth Law Center, and so it's earthlawcenter.org, and you can go, and they also will provide pro bono legal service support to you if you want to build an initiative in your local community.
I actually have a petition that is in my Instagram bio, and it's just kind of like for anyone who kind of like wants a way to help, and it's a petition that is going to be presented in the House of Commons for Truth and Reconciliation, so it's another way to help.
Go sign it. You all have to. I told you. Yes, professors too. And...
Well, thank you both very much. It's been great having this conversation with you. I've learned a lot. I hope everyone else has also learned a lot from this conversation. And I'd also like to thank the National Arts Center Orchestra and the Danish Royal Library for putting this all together. So thank you, and another round of applause for Dr. Kelsey Leonard and Autumn Peltier.